Hello there, folks. Today I'm doing something a little different. As you can see, the once white Blue Yeti is now black. I'm painting it with this Stuart Semple Black 3.0. This is like a special kind of paint that is supposed to absorb an absurd amount of light. So what that means is there's almost no light reflection off of this paint, and it turns out very black to the point where sometimes your eyes can't even perceive what it's seeing. I had this bright idea to paint my Blue Yeti with this paint because I thought if I did like a dark background, it might look like it's a floating mic. We'll see if that pans out. Fingers crossed. But you know, just kind of wanted to do it, so here we are. And since this is actually not my mic, it's a mic I borrowed from a friend. I guess she gifted it to me. She gave it to me because she has much better mics nowadays. I am just starting my ASMR channel. I was starting with zero equipment at all, so she gifted this to me. It's a hand-me-down, and to help me, you know, jumpstart my channel. So, because I didn't want to ruin her beautiful mic, and it's a white Blue Yeti, which I haven't seen a lot of these like pearl white ones, I didn't want to permanently paint it, so I actually covered the whole mic with painter's tape first. Then I did a layer of standard black paint, and then I did one layer of the black 3.0. Now I'm gonna do second layer of it, which I hope is the final layer. I hope it works, hopefully. One thing that I realized that is maybe making it not work as well is I bought this 2 years ago now, but then also I realized on the bottom it's 2011. You know, I don't know if this is a date, but if it is a date, it looks like it's made in 2011. Either way, whether it's from 2011 or from 2020, it feels like there's a chunk that has solidified in the bottle. And so, I'm wondering if it's underperforming, not giving the light absorbing effect that it's supposed to, you know, if it's dried out a little bit, but we'll give it a good try. What I call my palette is really just an old free frisbee, so, but it feels like a nice palette, you know. I don't feel like I paint enough to warrant buying an actual palette. So just to show you kind of what this paint is supposed to do, there's actually a spot where I missed it, and it's showing the standard black paint here, and then you can see the difference in reflectivity between, you know, a standard black acrylic paint and the black 3.0. That's just with one layer. We're doing a second layer today, and I'll fix this up, but just to kind of show you the effect it's supposed to have. You can see that. Well, yeah, you can really see that. So it does work. It's just not as... it's not as mind-bending as I want yet. You can also see on the cap here, like reflective black, and then the dried down black paint. So yeah, I wanted to do this on video, because, I mean, I was gonna do it anyway. And then I realized it might kind of sound cool to paint the mic and record. We'll see if that's true. Oh yeah, that's nice. If you haven't heard the story behind Stuart Semple's paint, I would highly suggest. There's a 99% Invisible podcast episode about this paint, and it's truly a wild ride. There's an extremely famous artist, Anish Kapoor, and you may know him from the Chicago Bean, which Anish Kapoor calls Cloudgate. But already goofed it a little. Okay, we're good. So what happened was Anish Kapoor is extremely famous artist, probably fairly rich, I don't really know, but he is kind of an embodiment of that stereotype of artists, you know, if they're a little full of themselves, in it for the money, in it for the fame. So anyway, completely outside of Anish Kapoor's work, some scientists developed what they called a carbon black. So it used carbon nanofibers, I think that's the word. It's like long carbon tubes on a molecular level, very tiny carbon tubes that absorb the light in this really weird way. So some scientists came up with this. I'm pretty sure it's originally for, you know, use in space. You know, I don't know what scientists do with it, but anyway. So they made this carbon black pigment, which at that point in time was the blackest substance pigment to have ever been observed. So they can measure like the amount of light that reflects off of it, and it was the lowest amount ever seen. And I'm not sure who reached out to who, but somehow Anish Kapoor got connected with these scientists, and they wanted to make a application method for the pigment. So, you know, it's just in like a powder form. It's not really easy to apply to an object or use it easily. And so Anish Kapoor was connected with these scientists, and they made a paint, or maybe they just made the pigment that he could put in various mediums. they made this pigment. They called it Vanta Black. And Anish Kapoor bought the soul rights. They made a deal with Anish Kapoor to have exclusive access to this pigment. Right now, I'm thinking of the thing that, you know, drama YouTubers often say, where they're like, oh, this is what I allegedly think. This is my alleged opinion. Don't sue me. And I feel like Anish is the kind of person who might sue some. Actually, he probably has. So, you know, this is just my recollection of a story that might have happened. It's funny that I feel the need to say that because I definitely don't have enough views on any of my videos or all of my videos combined for anyone to care. But you never know, right? Gotta plan for thousands of views. So anyway, you know, an artist buying exclusive rights to an artist's material is kind of the antithesis of the art world. You know, creatives want to play with new tools and mediums and pigments, and ideally the artist world would be collaborative and you know, support one each other and try to foster creativity in one another. So this idea of using vast amounts of wealth to call a color your own is just a little crazy. And there's some artists who have, you know, sort of invented a color, and had that been, and you know, made that their signature. So I'm blanking on the artist's name now. I'll put it on the screen. He's a French artist. He spent forever, like years and years, developing the shade of blue that he had sort of imagined in his mind. It didn't exist in the world yet. He did tons of research, worked with tons of scientists to develop this blue that he kind of thought of. You know, it didn't exist in the natural world, so no one had seen this blue before. It was before, you know, screen technology could make whatever color. And so no one had seen this color blue, and he pretty much invented a very specific shade of blue that couldn't be created with existing materials, flowers, pigments at that time. And so that, I kind of can see, like, that's his color. He made it. He conceived of it. He worked on developing it. He kind of made it from the ground up. It was kind of an idea that he synthesized. And so I can kind of understand him owning a color. I don't actually know if he patented it or not. I don't know his history as much, but that is more of a situation where I feel like it's justifiable for an artist to have a color be their own. But black is black. It's not like Anish Kapoor thought of that idea. It's not like it's some super specific color. You know, plenty of people try to get the maddest matte black or the whitest whites. Oh, I don't like that sound. It's terrible. Anyways, what I'm trying to say is it's not like he came up with this idea, and no one had ever heard of trying to find the blackest black paint before. And so I don't feel like he has any right to, own it, since he, you know, it wasn't a creative process on his end, as far as I know. And so, it feels a little unreasonable for an artist to just say, oh, well, I have so much money, I can just buy something for myself exclusively and prohibit others from using it if I want to, because money can buy you that. And so he did. And artists were so mad about it. It was like really the art drama at the time. Not that I really am in the loop on any art drama, but, you know, tons of news stories, tons of talk, and pretty much everyone was mad at Anish Kapoor for good reason. And so, you can kind of see like how it's drying, like it's shiny when it's wet, and then it's drying more black. That's cool. So people were all mad about it, because you should be more, sharing. It's caring. And so Stuart Semple, he's on the bottle, he decided to make his own super black paints, and make them available to everyone in the world except for Anish Kapoor. So he's been working on this for quite some time. He has a few different iterations. I guess he's on maybe the third, or maybe there's a fourth now, where they keep improving in quality, getting blacker and blacker. And I think this one is the same performance level as Anish Kapoor's Fanta Black. I'm not sure the exact stats on the performance level, but it's, you know, functionally the same, according to Stuart Semple. And so Stuart Semple has developed all these black paints. Oh, I forgot. He actually, instead of starting on the blackest black paint, he made, like, a pinkest pink paint. And was selling it to everyone in the world except Anish Kapoor. So if you buy paint on Stuart Semple's website, Culture Hustle, I think, there's like a checkbox where you have to say, I am not Anish Kapoor, and then you can buy it. But Anish Kapoor got his hands on the pinkest pink paint, and flipped the bird. Posted a picture of him flipping the bird with the pinkest pink paint on his metal finger. It's very, I think, emblematic of Anish Kapoor's personality. And so, since the pinkest pink, Mr. Resemble's been working on these blackest blacks to dupe the Fanta Black. So yeah, that's kind of the ongoing drama rivalry around this Black 3.0 paint. If you want to hear the actual reporting on it, like I said, you can look up 99. actress has the best voice. And his name is Roman Mars. Which is very cool. Supposed to be when it dries down. I don't really think it's expired, but now that I think about it, I don't think it's possible that it was made in 2011, because I don't think Black 3 was invented in 2011. I think it's pretty recent. Should still work to make it look like it's a floating mic against a dark background, because usually in my videos I dim the brightness so it's, you know, easier on the eyes if you're watching it to go to sleep. Worst case scenario, I will just take the tape off. I also kind of think the tape hurt the finish a little bit. It's a papery, you know, like a masking tape. I wonder if it's absorbing the paint, oddly. And also it's very textured. Precise with it, so tape is very textured, and you know, any of the texture is gonna be harder to hide than if it was completely smooth. Maybe if I really like the black paint, I'll try a fresh bottle and paint it straight onto the mic rather than doing. Of paint. One of the other black paint exhibits that I would love to see is the Rothko Chapel. Mark Rothko is an abstract artist you might have seen, kind of his pieces without realizing it, if you don't know who he is, you've probably seen it anyway. He's very famous. He does swaths of textured, layered colors in squares, rectangles, and primarily on giant canvases, so that when you're standing and looking at the piece, it kind of envelops your field of vision completely with the colors that he created. Most of his pieces are fairly colorful, but he did a set of pieces using pretty much all black paint in different shades. So, you know, nothing is truly black. Black is the absence of color, so we can't replicate that perfectly. So, you know, there are some blacks that have a bluish tinge, greenish, warm, dark, dark, dark brown, dark, dark, dark orange. And so he did a series of pieces that are just layering those different black colors alongside one another, and you can see the depth of the black colors and the, you know, the shades of the black. The color of the black paint starts to be perceivable in your eye once your brain, your eyes become accustomed to it. So they're all located in Rocco Chapel, I think in Houston, Texas, outside Houston. And you know, I don't think it's actually religious, but it's called chapel because it's a meditative space. You know, you can stare into the black abyss of these paintings and sort of focus so much on that that you are in a state of meditation, focusing on the painting rather than your day-to-day thoughts. And I would love to go see it one day. Try this new thing in my videos where I pick a emoji for each video for people to comment on the video with that emoji. It feels somewhat corporate asking people to comment on my videos, but you know, it's YouTube. I'm not gonna be making any money on this anyway. I just want people to see it if they're interested in seeing it. So, I suppose I should pick an emoji for this video. Let's say Black Ace of Spades emoji. Comment if you're still watching. I got the idea from Celeste. She's a tattoo YouTuber. Recommend her. If feeling, Dentus. Alright, I feel like I've gotten most of the surface area with another layer. I think that this paint, you know, it'll take some time to fully dry down and be at its fullest potential. It's obviously not matte when it's wet, so might take a little bit of time. Right on top of the blue logo. Okay. That's good. Alright, feeling decent about this. Hopefully it looks, I think it does look kind of cool. Even though it's not completely dried down, I feel like it already looks kind of cool on the camera. I definitely wouldn't say full potential. You can see even the color difference in black on the shaded side versus the lighter side. Like, yeah. So it's not, you know, really doing what it's intended to do. But for the purposes of YouTube, it'd be good. Let's just hope that one day when I take the tape off, I'll have not goofed up the whole mic. So that's the whole video. You'll see the final results in future videos. So much for watching. Comment the black spade emoji, please.